In this video, we'll be simplifying rational expressions. And remember, simplifying a rational expression is just like simplifying a fraction. So basically, you're just reducing fractions. And to reduce fractions, you need to factor. So here's an example, 8x cubed over 6x. We've done problems like this before. One way of doing it is completely factoring the numerator into single factors. And the bottom we just have 2 times 3 times x, and then any common factor you can cancel. So I can cancel out of x, I can out of the top, and an x out, a 2 out of the top and bottom, and an x out of the top and bottom. So that will give me what's left. I have a 2, and an x at the top. That's going to be a 4x squared, and in the bottom I'm going to have a 3. Now, you would get the same answer by doing regular canceling. And then x cubed over x to the first, you could subtract exponents and get x squared for the numerator. So you should still get 4x squared over 3. All right, what if you had something like this? 5 plus 2x over 2x plus 5. Now, you have to be careful here. It's tempting to try to cancel out the 2x's and to cancel out the 5, but that's not how it works, because the numerator is the whole quantity 5 plus 2x, and the denominator is the entire quantity 2x plus 5. So you can only cancel out a 5 plus 2x with another 5 plus 2x. So the question is, are these the same? And in fact, they are. If you use the commutative property, you could write the top one as 2x plus 5 if you want to see them written out exactly the same. And then when you cancel, they both completely cancel out, so you get a 1 for the answer. Now, what if it had been 5 minus 2x over 2x minus 5? Now, I did some problems like these when I was doing factoring. 5 minus 2x is actually the opposite of 2x minus 5. Do you remember that if you have a minus sign and then you're just switching the order of what's being subtracted, then they're opposite. So if I want, I could pull out it, if you want to see it, you could pull out a negative 1 and write this as 2x minus 5. So you could really see you're going to be able to cancel out that 2x minus 5. And you should convince yourself this is true again, because negative 1 times 2x is negative 2x. See the negative 2x here? And negative 1 times negative 5 is plus 5. So when I cancel, I'm left with negative 1. Now, you don't have to do this middle step. Some people may say, oh, these are opposites, and when you cancel opposites, the answer is just going to be negative 1. You can do that as well. For instance, if you have 15 over 15, we know the answer is 1, but if I have negative 7 over positive 7, those are opposites, right? So the answer is negative 1. It's very similar. So if you have 2 minus 3y, over 3y minus 2. If you recognize these are opposites of each other, you say, oh, the answer is negative 1. It's very similar. Okay, here's another one. Again, resist the temptation to try to cancel unless you have something completely factored. So, you put parentheses around the numerator and denominator before you start every single one of these problems, as a reminder. Right, so in both the numerator and denominator, there's only two terms, and there's only two things you could do when you have two terms. You can either take out a common factor, or it could be the difference of two squares. And if you know the formulas for the sum of difference in two cubes, those are two other possibilities. So what's the common factor here? That's what we look for first in any problem, x. So I've got x times x minus 3. And in the denominator, the common factor is 2. So I have x minus 3. And of course, you know, I'm going to give you problems that Usually there's going to be something you can cancel. It'll also be really boring. And you could anticipate that even when you're doing some problems. You're going to guess. They probably have some common factors in the numerator and denominator or some opposites. In real life, it hardly ever happens. But, you know, in a math book and on a math test, yes, you're going to be given problems that you're probably going to be able to do something with. Okay, here's another problem. Again, the first thing we're going to look for when we have two terms is there a common factor? So in the numerator, we have a common factor of y. All right, so that'll give you 5x minus 3. I'm going to guess there's probably going to be a 5x minus 3 or a 3 minus 5x in the bottom. Something else would be kind of boring, right? What's the common factor here for 9 minus 15x? 3. 3 minus 5x. Oh, just as I suspected. So these are opposites. So we just went over this. If they're opposites, you can cancel and you get a negative 1. Alternatively, you can rewrite the problem like this. Pull out a negative sign out of here and write that as 5x minus 3. So that would be another a step if you wanted to write it. If you do this way I showed you, then you have y times negative 1, which is negative y, or you could just put the minus sign out in front of the fraction bar. Either way, you could put the minus sign right in front of the y, or you could put it in front of the parentheses. And you would get the same thing here, right? You have one minus sign, so again, you could just put the minus sign out in front. Usually we don't leave minus signs in the denominator, though. We usually would write it in front of the fraction bar or up in the numerator. All right, here's another problem. Again, resist the temptation. You may not cancel out those n squares. Okay, we need to factor. So in the numerator, you can factor as the difference of two squares, or you could change it to a minus and then parentheses n squared minus 4. I'm just going to go ahead and do it as the difference of two squares, 2 plus n times 2 minus n. And now in the denominator, we have a quadratic here, the trinomial. So it's got to be an n and an n. Then we want factors of 10 that have a difference of 3. That's going to be 5 and 2. It's going to have to be a minus 5 and a plus 2. Okay, so what's going to happen here? I have a 2 plus n. Is there a 2 plus n in the denominator? Well, there's an n plus 2, and those are exactly the same. So we can cancel. So I've got 2 minus n over n minus 5. Now, you might see someone write this differently. They might factor a minus sign out of the top and just put it in the front, and then that would be n minus 2. Now remember, when there's a minus sign out in front of a fraction, you either put it with the numerator or the denominator. You don't do it with both, because then you'd be multiplying by a negative 1 and another negative 1. So the answer wouldn't be negative anymore. So just as a reminder, negative 3, well, let's do something more obvious. Negative 6 over 2, we know is negative 3, right? You could think of that as negative 6 divided by 2, which is negative 3. Or you could think of it as 6 divided by negative 2, which is negative 3. But negative 6 over negative 2 would give you positive 3. So you see how you can't put the negative sign in both places. So watch out. Be careful with negative signs. Those negative signs trip lots of people up. Let's do one more. Okay, see if you could do this on your own and then come back. Okay, well, the numerator can't be factored any further. 2x plus 1, because there's no common factor, not a difference, so it can't be a difference of two squares. Now, in the denominator, I'm going to think about this. Hey, if this was an interesting problem, One of the factors down here is going to be 2x plus 1, so I can cancel. I'm going to guess. For my trial factors, I'm going to see if 2x plus 1 is the correct factor. Well, if it was the correct factor, 2x times what will give you 12x squared? 6x. And 1 times what will give you a negative 1? And then just do a double check. And when you do the FOIL method, indeed, it actually does equal 12x squared plus 4x minus 1. So we cancel the 2x plus 1s, and here's the very important part. The answer is not 6x minus 1. There's a 1 in the numerator. Don't forget. So it's 1 over 6x minus 1. And there you go.
I hope you learned something. Remember, math is cool.